and they chose to go red?
I'm not sure, actually, because they came in as seed 5 overall in the bracket.
But they Chantal Actuao was seed number 2.
I'm not sure. I'd have to kind of think back about how the seeding is done.
Somebody in production will tell us that one.
No, I'm fairly certain Chantal Actuao just came in as seed 4 straight up.
Okay.
That's my understanding of this one. Yeah.
Okay.
Chantal Actuao comes as the higher seed, picks side blue, so it's okay. First pick, Shyvana does come in. With Jax removed, they're going to pick Shyvana there to contest the top lane. It seems to be one of the popular top laners here.
Yeah, Shyvana has a lot of wins and a lot of picks. I think she's one of the most one-with champions currently in the LCS, right alongside Lucian. Kind of pushed Renekton out of being the popular top laner because she just scales so well. She shows up to the fights.
Yeah.
And even if she runs away, she still does a lot of damage with the burnout just trailing behind her.
Yeah, it's all kinds of incredible. She's a really good fighter, and her laning phase is good as well. Her ability to turn around fights is awesome. So Thresh, Lee Sin as well comes through for Morden. Morden's been playing Lee Sin consistently throughout this tournament. Basically, he's a big Lee Sin player. He plays it a whole bunch in ranked 5s as well. So on the other side, Kha'Zix gets grabbed to try to face off against him 1v1, and Lucian gets traded over to Chantal Actuao.
Yeah, Twitch banned out. Lucian's still available. They pick it up for themselves. Leave a lot of things open for Yuki. He was a Graves player for a very long time. He can still fall back on Draven and try to bully the Lucian at the same time. Mm-hmm. But not sure what they're going to go with here.
Well, they got to make sure, probably their top lane picks right now at this point, you might as well counterpick the mid laner since no team's looking to rush pick it. The hover on Kog'Maw, no, Jinx actually is interesting though, because Shyvana and Kha'Zix can both reach that champion, so it puts a lot of stress on Diu to keep Yuki alive.
Yeah, and we're going to have to see how that pans out for him. He does have the Thresh with the Lantern to keep him to safety, mm-hmm. but Jinx is also what Shantao was playing throughout the round of 10 and round of 20.
Yeah.
That's the champion that he had that great performance where he was 10, 2, and 5 and carried the team. So he has that potential here. In Gamers 2, they can synergize that with an Orianna on Ocelot. LeBlanc still does a lot of AoE damage and can lower people, so the Death Rocket does more.
Yeah.
A lot here for them.
It's actually a good point as far as Gamers 2 is concerned, is they've actually got this AoE burst from Jinx. The Orianna could help that out, but of course, that's been grabbed here by Avenue. So this team's got a lot of great ways of engaging fights for Chantal Actuao, and Lucian's going to be safe on his back line just contributing.
Yeah, so Gamers 2, there's a lot of things that you could do here. You can go with the LeBlanc, you can go Roam.
Yeah.
You can actually pick up Nidalee, which is still available for Ocelot. You can become a Poke comp. There is a lot of engage on Chantal Actuao here, though.
Yeah, this doesn't feel like a team that would want a Nidalee,
though. They wouldn't want it, but it's still there, and it's a little tempting, because Nidalee is very, very
sure. So I gotta say, Nid Orianna is not my favorite matchup either, though.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like there's a lot of reasons not to Nidalee here. Now, maybe they're gonna pull out something that we're not expecting on this one, but LeBlanc, I think, is probably the safer choice for that one. You mentioned at the very beginning, champs like this champion's still available. The fact that it got to go to 10th pick and no one cared enough to grab it is interesting to me, but that is going to go over to Ocelot here. So LeBlanc versus Orianna in the mid lane, Shyvana versus Aurelia up in the top. That was the solo lane matchup.
He's getting a lot of practice on that LeBlanc. That's his most played in solo queue currently, what he's been doing underneath the radar, but he will pick Kasten over that every day.
So oh, sure.
Ended up banning that out for him.
Yeah.
Very mobile champion in the same regard that Kasten is. Very quick, very easy to get around the map, very hard to catch.
Yeah.
Very annoying to play against.
Yeah, he's a really good roamer, and so is LeBlanc. You can sit in lane forever and just, you know, use the distortion of the Athenes and whatnot to do that, but Ocelot's roaming is really what won them the game the first time around. I mean, his overall score, right, 12-2 and 18, he's been involved in a whole lot of kills for his team. I think that's actually a very important point for them. And the fact that he's been able to help out Yuki and Diu, again, the zero-death bot lane is the one I'm going to look for consistency. If SMW can shake that, that's going to be a big point for them.
Yeah. What I'm looking at here is the Lucian alongside the Morgana versus a Thresh Jinx.
Yeah.
Morgana does very, very well against Thresh. All of his moves are very telegraphed. You can just put up the Black Shield and walk straight through the box.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're fine. You can go ahead and use it on a hook. He has to play it right, though. I think that this deathless bottom lane isn't going to be deathless anymore.
Yeah, I think it's very unlikely, especially considering it's a best of three. I expect them to fall at some point here. I mean, Shantou and Sazed are ludicrously skilled players. What's interesting to me, actually, about this Shantou Actuao team is four of their players are currently in Challenger Ladder.
Mm-hmm.
Like, individual skill-wise, these guys are way up there, super top tier. Gamers, too, they're almost better because they're a team, because they've been playing together for a long time is how they've done so well, because only one of them is actually in Challenger Ladder. And I know we don't talk about that a lot in terms of LCS, when you're like, well, we've seen these guys for a while. You've got guys like Shifter, who, okay, yeah, sure, they're top 20, but we know him from LCS play. Or, you know, we've got guys like Weevil Failure, who you don't really care what their ladder performance is. You see them on the screen, you know they're good. In this kind of case, where you don't see these guys as much, we talk about ladder performances, and it usually means a fair bit. So individual skill-wise, I mean, honestly, blue team looks really good, even though Gamers 2 has the name recognition.
And now all of Shantae Act Wild, you know, they're grouped up here. They don't have the name recognition. They've actually been around for a while. I think they've been around for a year, since January in 2013.
Wow.
And they've been playing together. I think they tried to qualify for a previous promotion tournament.
Creative Flash is no big deal. Continue.
Yeah, that was about it. They've tried to qualify previously. They've been around. We're going to have to see how this works out for him here. We do see the Avenue. He's taken the barrier for himself.
Yeah, we have seen barrier be a lot more common ever since Heal stopped removing previous wounds and whatnot. That was always kind of the case. It's like barrier was always better as a selfish save me skill. And people are sort of realizing that skill is still very good. I like that heals run in the dual lane because you can help your teammate, but otherwise no big deal. The ward
speed still.
I do got to point out this ward that got put down right here by Gamers 2. That ward was seen by turrets when it went down. So Gamers 2 knows that they're looking for that lane matchup, and this team's got to play around those wards to get into the lane properly.
Yeah, there's actually only one route that Thresh can take right now and not get seen by a ward.
There's actually none. All of his routes are covered. There's two more wards coming in.
Well,
he went through the jungle.
Yeah, that's true.
Could he go through the bottom jungle?
He'd have to go all the way around and then...
Oh my god, yeah. Over the blue buff?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So they're going to show that it is going to be the two in the bottom, and that's what they're looking for. They wanted that because they have the better bottom lane matchup.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Yeah, and we talked about that. Morgana Lucian's going to do a lot better job. Lucian picked for his laning phase. And yeah, to actually key off your point, Gamers 2 didn't see the ward go down in river. Jinx was already forced to flash, so he didn't know he was actually revealing himself.
Yeah.
So Shantae Machiavelli, they find their 2-on-2. Morden, he has to solo up his red buff. They're going to try to hide maybe where his lanes were starting, where his jungle pattern was. So right now, Shantae, maybe just because of their jungle wards, can infer the Lee Sin jungle route, but they don't know for sure that Morden started topside.
Very scary, though, because that means he will be bottom by around that three-minute mark, and that will be most likely his first gank. Saze does not have flash anymore, burned it to try and get the Dark Binding, so he won't have that available in a gank. If they hold off on it, it's quite possible they could get a catch there, but at the same time, if there isn't a play made, while Kha'Zix is on the top side of the map, he's going to walk all the way back down.
Oh, they have the play. Saze gets rooted up, half health, a lot of health loss on him. He does have the summoner heal, burns that there, exhausted onto Yuki, but a big health bar lead to Gamers 2.
Level 2 comes out for Gamers 2 early. Satane is on the complete opposite side of the map. Morden, he only has one summoner spell in that bottom lane to even deal with. It's the flash on Shantae. They have no exhaust, no heal, no flash on Morgana. Saze is pretty much, if you get to him, he's gone.
Yeah. Yeah, they got a health bar lead and the two summoner spell lead. A lot of stress here now on these guys. The mid lane matchup, 15 to 13, pretty equal in minions. Ocelot makes a bit of a bad move there, takes half his health bar down, but will sustain up with his flask. But Avenue, good early start to this lane.
Yeah, Ocelot knew he was going to get bullied around with auto attack harassment as well as attack command attacks. Mm-hmm. So he brings the flask to lane, and he's able to risk this. Now he actually has a regen advantage over Avenue.
Yeah, true.
By a pretty large margin here.
Yeah, Avenue's running out of mana by, you know, he's got to really rely on this Doran's Ring regen to get his mana bar back up to the point where he can actually deal some damage out. Otherwise, it's going to be a one-sided matchup pretty soon. Yeah. Morden doesn't really find any lanes that he can quite gank. He sees top lanes pushed up, bot lanes on the wrong side of the map, so going to keep farming for now. Satane could maybe find something bot. Problem is, they haven't seen Morden in a really long time. And, you know, as we've seen, counter ganks can completely ruin a matchup. Sazed, not going to jump in.
Junglers are just completely mirroring each other on the complete opposite sides of the map. So they really haven't coincided in a certain area. They both went mid for a bit, and then they're like, nope, back to farming. So this jungle style is kind of wait for an opportunity to really present itself.
Well, Kha'Zix just got spotted, actually. I saw Gamers 2 ping the mid lane saying Kha'Zix is mid right now. They saw him cross to top side jungle. So right now, Morden knows...
just expired bottom.
Ooh, if he didn't get seen, he knows there's no counter gank.
Morden...
dude's looking for it. There's a flash play. They're going to go in for this one. Where's the lantern, though? He goes for the hook on the black shield to target. Some damage comes through. Saze, low on health, but lands the root onto Dude. It's going to be the survival for all these guys.
It was a little telegraphed at that point. If he could stuck around a little longer and Gamers 2 didn't go as aggressive, maybe he could have gotten something out of it because they gave away his position very, very early on.
Yeah, well, no gank did come through, or the gank came through, but it was stymied there. Satane, nice play by him, realizes that this... gank could happen and goes to invade the jungle. Wraiths and double golems would be his if he wants to go for it. Does counter jungle the Wraith camp, and Horton's back in his own jungle. Nice hook's gonna land on a Shantou. Big damage comes through. Good Black Shield stops the flay, though. And it's just damage.
Damage still pretty big, though.
Yeah.
Mid laners are both backed. Doran's rings in the inventories. Just looking for those extra beefy duelist stats early on so they don't lose the lane. Very even in CS across the board. Ooh, just close hooks. The bottom lane and the mid lane here. Very indicative of what's going to happen in this game. But right now, it's very even.
Yeah, for all the summoner spell losses, to be fair, Gamers2 haven't really capitalized on that very much. You're going to see actually a CS lead for Shantou Mox Vow, right? So I got to say, that's pretty impressive stuff by these guys. Top lane held pretty equal as well. JWoww recalled for an early Sapphire Crystal. I'm very surprised to see that being his first buy, but he wants to rush the Sheen, and he couldn't afford the Amp Tome. I mean, Amp Tome would be useless, so why not? But
yeah.
I know Sheen first is like the build, but I very rarely see Sapphire Crystal first on Aurelia. That's all I'm going to say.
She does have pretty decent mana cost if you're spamming it. And Satane walks straight through a ward, straight up. He wants Dude. He knows the flash isn't up. Binding.
Ooh, yeah, not quite going to be enough for these guys. So backing out at level 5 here after his cannon jungling escapades. Morden cleared out his own jungle recently.
It's kind of a lazy gank. Just, I'm coming bottom.
Trying.
Not even going to leap.
Yeah. We don't want to leap into a Thresh. No, you'll get CC'd and die most likely. JWoww, Vanez having a bit of a fight there on this one. Level 6 now on these guys. Ulti's had been burned by the Aurelia, and it's going to push back down. CS only going to be about 3 apart for these guys.
JWoww spamming the Blade Surge to clear minion waves and try to get him to the turret as fast as possible. Also burned his ultimate as soon as he had it.
Ooh, Satan already waiting for Morden. Yeah, big damage. Q comes out there. They're still going for the battle, though. Morden, Waz, got to be careful. Max Q does a bunch of pain right there. Gamers2 trying to keep him alive.
They're on the wrong side of the map now.
Yeah. Uh-oh, the binding is going to be a lot of damage as well. Good play, a whole bunch of damage there. The exhaust on top of that one. Yuki down to 200 health. This has got to be a bit careful in this one. Summoner heal burned. Maybe premature, but they're going to get away.
It's a little far there. There we go.
Dude tanks the binding just to make sure his teammate's safe, and they're going to back out.
Back to farming.
Yep.
Just gentleman's agreement. You know, you go along your way, sir. Yes, thank you. And they go back to what they're doing. Avenue and Ocelot had a little tussle back and forth there in the jungle. But Seikane really didn't do much after he got the initial burst onto Morden there. Didn't overextend.
Yeah.
Just secured his buff.
Well, again, realize that, like, the bot lane for Gamers2 showed up first. If you go in, you die to a Thresh. So
yeah.
Both these guys have been pretty measured in their aggression. No one's overextended. Maybe a couple missed skill shots here and there might have given them kills when they wouldn't have had them otherwise, or when they didn't in this game. But as far as plays go, people are making very smart choices.
And the thing here is that it delayed Morden's jungle, the attempted invade to place the ward. So that Satane is going to get this blue over to Avenue before Ocelot gets his, and Satane could position for a gank, and there's no chance that Morden's going to be around because he's going to be too busy trying to hand off the blue.
Well, right now, though, Satan's going to actually cash in on the top lane. He's maybe expecting the blue buff attempt right here. JWoww's not going to see him. He's going to go for the top lane here. There we go. Dragonform used by Vanez. A jump in onto JWoww. Good damage comes through, but Satan's got to be a bit careful. Pops the ulti. Some more burst comes through. JWoww does go down. First blood goes over to Vanez.
And because of the delayed jungle, there's no possible way that he could have been there. Morden.
He's waiting for Kha'Zix on the way back down, okay. I think.
Yeah, he's looking for him to come back down because he knows he's low HP. Actually goes for the white.
I think Morden was expecting, potentially, because I don't think, no, he already saw that blue buff was on Orianna.
Yeah.
He was maybe looking for Satan on the way back down, but he didn't go for more.
Now we have Chalice coming out for both mid laners here. Once again, just looking for the duel, the sustain. They want to keep their CS up. Ocelot's actually winning right now.
Yeah, Ocelot's doing a phenomenal job there. 10 minion lead, recalls again. Second recall for both mid laners. Good Black Shield. Keeps Shantou safe. He's barking orders in his bottom lane, letting him know. Shield me. He vows.
Now, Morden securing his vows with Ocelot.
Yep.
And the blue buff. Give him a gift.
There you go. Keeping them all nice and safe. There we go. Blue buff cleared.
It's the dowry.
14 and a half minute respawn on that one. Satane. Oh, good guy Satane gives Avenue the kill.
Yeah. A lot of the action is going to spawn from this mid lane because the lanes are pretty evenly matched. Solo kills and the junglers, you know, they're kind of keeping each other in check.
Yeah.
The mid lane here, Ocelot has an advantage in terms of CS, a little bit in the item department too. Because, well, actually, no, that's actually wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's an item advantage here for Avenue.
Yeah, because all the flask money basically will be an Amp Tome behind, but, you know, it might not mean too much for these guys.
It's not combat stats, it's sustain, but at this point in the game, you already have so much sustain in terms of not taking your damage, you're like, You don't like. I don't even have to sustain. I have the ranges here.
Yeah, it's basically he bought the CS lead with the flask.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like, okay, now if this can pay off for the rest of the time, like.
Exactly.
Well, we'll see if this is going to happen there. Morden once again looking into the jungle. Nice ward right there. He's actually, Gamer's been doing a very good job of putting wards down aggressively in the jungle. Like the ward on SMW's red buff just timed out a second ago, and they were kind of tracking moves with that one. Vanaz and JWoww again in a bit of a duel, but they're holding pretty equal. Despite the kill, I gotta say, JWoww still doing a really, really good job in this top lane.
Yeah, his CS is very, very close to the 10 per minute already, and Shantau gets caught.
A lot of burst comes out, nothing to save him at all. Saves pops the ultimate, he's got almost nowhere to go. Exhaust burn, but I don't know if it's gonna be enough. The stuns come out, binding. No dodge there, but Ocelot now in the back lines. Vanaz gotta be careful. Oh. Does dodge the W. Ignite is on, but here comes Satane on top of him. The flash, the autos, the huge damage. Is he gonna guess properly? Yes, he will. Ocelot goes down. The jukes by Vanaz in the kill. The counter gank there by Satane.
Not really guessing when he has a blue under his feet.
True.
At that point.
True.
That was a good gank there. And he's gonna get more.
Ooh, he gets a bit of a slow there, but the W, is it gonna be enough? I don't think it's going to be. He's gonna back out.
Nope. Claws aren't that long. No, no,
even if they were evolved.
Q. Yeah, very close, though. Yeah.
So it's going to be the teleport back into the lane by Vanaz. Actually, not going the Sunfire rush, rushing a Randuin's to survive this matchup better, realizing how hard his life is against JWoww, who has finished the Sheen, is going towards Zeal. Very damage focused build, but that's the typical case for early game Aurelia.
Yeah. Top lane, we see Vanaz has already swapped out his trinket for a sweeper, and he's actually just buying the trinkets or the wards for himself. Mm-hmm. And tried to sweep him out, but he actually didn't get anything.
I actually don't see top laners switch to sweepers that early on. That's actually not traditional here. So interesting to see that one. Normally mid laners switch first, but that's not the case. So, okay, different choice for these guys. I want to see how it pays out because he'll be a bit less safe to pay for it. Satane going through a ward that will land the W. Good damage down on a JWoww. Can they get enough? The ulti popped again. Will land one slow, but here comes Ward on the backside. They've got to be careful. JWoww picks up one, and Vaughn is forced to run away. They forced that gank too hard. And it was actually a solo kill for JWoww without Morden.
They went straight through a ward, but because of the sweeper lens, he probably told his jungler there's no ward in this area right here. So he came across, blew his ultimate, overextended, and JWoww still had flash. He was completely safe in that.
Yeah. That was a bad estimation there by Shantau Machiavelli. They gave away.
Good bait by Gamer.
Yeah, I mean, that was just JWoww like saying, great, I'll 1v2 you. That was rather unfortunate there. So it is still a small gold lead for Shantau Machiavelli. I gotta say that's impressively done so far. Bot lane, again, it's the case here. Like a lane gives up a kill, but they're still holding on pretty equally. Vaughn is once again looking for JWoww, can't quite find it. Dragonform just gonna clear the minions away. No teleports up for a minute and a half, but if he roams down bot, which maybe they're for the ulti, they could take dragon.
Yeah, so far, like you said, the dragon. Nobody's made a move for it. Nobody's capitalized off of these kills because they've been mostly in the top lane in the off that in that area. There was one down bottom, but it was very actually a little early on, and there was no jungle.
It was just the 2-on-2,
It was the 2-on-2, so the jungler would have had to be right in that area, but he's actually top of the side.
Good damage goes through. Diu done a half HP on that one. Forced to run away. Flax shield is burned to keep him safe. Avenue does spell shield some of the damage, but here comes Morden. Big damage available. Barry going to keep him alive a little bit longer. Flashes back towards his turret. He will stay safe. Good shockwave hits Ocelot. Gigantic damage from Satane. Ocelot's going to jump over to the right-hand side. Burst going to come out. Ooh, the Jinx Rocket nearly catches on, but Satane does solo him out. Now Morden, forced run away, does land the slow. One more W. Will that be enough to leap the Q? Yes, it is. Satane picks up the double kill. Diu forced a flash over the wall. Wow, this jungler making everything happen.
Dude was looking for the lantern save and then got pinched off there. Now, yep. Satane, 100% kill participation, goes straight for the dragon here because he's right in the perfect position. We see Satane actually jumps in while he has his Void Assault on, and then that was a really good shockwave there to lock up Ocelot. He thought it was the second one, and then he's like, oh, wait, nope, it just used Distortion. I'm going to go after this one. Picks up the kill for it, and then Morden tries to juke through the bush for just a second. And that cannon minion, though, look at that guy.
Helping out. Assist cannon minion in that one. 150 gold goes to the cannon.
It's better than most of my teammates.
Oh, man. That's just harsh. Well, top lane, though. This one's under pressure right here. Vanaz hasn't been able to do too much in this lane, unfortunately, except finish a Randuin. And Satan's going to give a blue buff over to his mid lane compatriot. Gamer Studio Blue has also respawned. We haven't seen any team able to truly counter jungle yet. It's just been kind of the lane gank so far. Avenue survives this run-in with Ocelot. Going to be safe on this one. Athene's actually only done for Avenue here, so that is a lead that's pretty meaningful.
Yeah, he's going to be able to harass as much as possible. He now has a CS lead over Ocelot, which we didn't see previously.
True.
He's been able to capitalize on the two deaths that Ocelot has given over. And now they have a 2,500 gold lead here in favor of Chantal Mokthwao. But a lot of this is coming from Satain. He's making the moves in every lane. Mm-hmm. He's been mid, he's been top, he's been bottom. He's all over the map. Morden hasn't really shown himself too much bottom.
Yeah.
Hasn't really shown himself in other areas. Satain is actually forcing the ganks as much as he possibly can. Sometimes they're a little extended, but he's still making moves. Morden a level down.
Yeah.
Because of this.
Morden's really, like, and he picked Lee Sin with everything on the table. He wanted the Lee Sin to look for counter jungles, look for the solo plays. And Satain picked Kha'Zix afterwards, and I really have not seen anything great happen yet for Morden. His gank bottom lane, he tried once, got revealed. Satain will get around the ward for the most part, but another one's in the tribe rush that keeps the team safe. He's going to go back out of this one, so ulti burn for pretty much nothing with the ward going down. Morden now looking to force bottom lane with Ocelot joining.
It's a 4-on-2 here. He's coming straight behind them, and he's going to try to set this up. You don't usually see this coming at all. They have no idea.
Oh no, Sei's in the really wrong spot right there. Big damage comes through onto him. Pops the ulti as well to try to spell vamp up. Exhaust is onto Yuki. He flashes away, but also picks up the kill. 1-0 so far. Here comes Vanez with the teleport on to try to join the team. Can he get much for this? Looks like not. So just the 1-0 and the burn teleport.
And now, meanwhile, Satain walks into the jungle, places a ward. Avenue gets the mid turret for it. So it's a kill for a turret. The roam. Satain actually is going to rotate top so that none of that experience is missed, none of that gold is missed, and that JWoww doesn't get turret damage.
And we're going to see that Gamer Stu really doesn't get anything off that kill either. They could have stayed bot and pushed down, but they're really just saying, we'll pick up kills, then play slowly.
They're not capitalizing.
They're really not.
That's the big thing here from Gamer Stu, is that they are not capitalizing off of the kills that they get. They make moves for them like they did right there, but they didn't get a turret afterwards. They did outnumber it, and they saw that Avenue was taking middle, and there was no chance of saving that.
Well, they get it now.
Yeah.
So, I guess they had the confidence in their bot lane to be like, you know, without the support, Jinx will get free damage down. Maximize the time of their jungler in this one, but I still want to see, you know, some more things happen. See what else these guys can grab. Right there, it's a 1,700 gold lead here, one turret to one. Chantal Mokthwao hold a one kill lead as well.
And a dragon.
And the dragon, yeah, I was going to say, and the dragon's on top of that one. So, I've honestly just seen more impressive moves so far by Chantal Mokthwao.
And coming into this, people have been saying that Gamers 2 is the team that's going to test Chantal Mokthwao.
Yeah.
It's true, and so far, they're holding up to the test.
Yes.
And now they're kind of acing it.
They're passing. Yeah, they're above the curve.
There you go.
If you 2-0, it comes to acing.
Yeah, acing is pretty big.
If you kill five people before they respawn, that would actually literally
that
be
would
acing.
Be an ace, yeah.
So we're gonna save it for that one. Morden level 10, Satain level 11 on top of a friendly pink ward. Means he knows he's not been revealed just yet. But doesn't quite have anything to do.
JWoww's hitting some power spikes here. He is really close to the Trinity Force. He has 30 CS over his opponent here. Yeah, there we go. He's got the Trinity Force. That's power spike for him. He's level 12, so he'll have two abilities maxed at this point when he hits 13. And then he'll be able to just push the Shyvana over for a good while, actually. Shyvana has no damage. She's just going to try to tank it up. The Randuin's is a good first buy because it'll reduce the attack speed. And a lot of Aurelia's damage is based on her Hiten style damage.
It's very attack speed based. So something to watch for. More ward coverage right now for Gamers 2.
Looking for a
looking to make plays, yeah.
Cheeky gank here from Morden and Dude.
Sage gets revealed as he walks through the jungle. He's actually going to be right on top of them. He puts the ward down, but nearly sweeps that one away. Pink ward definitely revealed in that brush, so we'll see if they can sweep it away.
It's tempting, though. When you know there's a pink ward in the bush, you're like, I got to get it. They're like, I know he wants to get it.
Well, he's going to try again. Lantern comes out.
Ooh, they go straight over into this bush. In the side. Oh.
They sweep away the pink ward
They do nothing with it. JWoww pushes that advantage top and immediately gets a turret for himself. Meanwhile, Vanna's had to back.
Yeah. This top lane is winning by itself right here for Gamers 2. It's
not a good place to be.
Yeah, I mean, thing is, they're slowly growing advantages there, but until we see JWoww really join a fight, it doesn't mean anything yet for the team. So I want to see, 35 seconds till Dragon, right? Triforce is done. If they can use that to do something, Gamers 2 can get a foothold back in this game, but if only a top lane's winning, you got to do something with it.
Yeah, I think the big thing here is that teleport is up for JWoww, and it's not up for Vanez. So when that Dragon spawns, there's a lot of pressure that can be applied by JWoww. Vanez, on the other hand, he has a whole turret to take for himself. JWoww already got this one. He can push the lane up if he wants to. He can harass Vanez, and if he comes out on top, then it's immediately a 4-on-5, and Gamers 2 will basically get the dragon conceded over to them by Chantal.
We're going to see the blue buff right now being taken away. Okay. So at least Avenue's got his power spike here for this one with the blue buff on there. And already Gamers 2 is starting this one out. The team is there for this one. Look at that. With ward control and everything, Gamers 2 is crushing this down. They timed it off the blue buff respawn, actually. And Avenue Satan in the wrong spot for that one. Grats to Gamers 2, bringing it back to a 200 gold game.
So JWoww, instead of using the teleport to get into it, said Gamers 2 is already in position for it. I will just walk halfway down. If you guys need me, I'm there. Or I can just walk back up without having to blow my teleport. Mm-hmm. So he still has that summoner spell for if a fight breaks out. And they are they're surrounding Satan right now. He was standing on a ward.
He's got almost nowhere to go. There's the red buff coming up. The ward comes down as well. There's a lantern. Dude's going to help this one out. Nice push right there. And the flash to the leap's going to keep him pretty safe. JWoww not going to go any farther in that one, but it's a forced flash for that trinket ward.
It's a good escape. It allowed Vanis some free farm time. Now he's only 20 CS behind JWoww. He is pushing the wave up, and Warden is going to be able to secure his own red here. So it's basically just jungle chess is what's happening.
Yeah.
And if you make one wrong move, it's going to cost you. We saw Warden give up his flash earlier for trying to invade, and right there, Satan blows his.
Yeah, so that's one thing lost for this one. You're seeing the top lane brawl continue. JWoww versus Vanis. Once Vanna does pull him into a brush and, you know, get some minion aggro, you have some decent damage come out of that Shyvana, but JWoww's continuing to sort of build a lead in this matchup. Up over 20 CS, already got the turret as we mentioned before. The threat of him did earn Gamers 2 a dragon, but it's a very, very slow game. I've not seen any team group up for real pushes. It's been either I won my lane and got the kill for it, or you roamed out so I took your turret down, or then occasionally they'll capitalize off a champion kill, but team's taking a good long time to make any moves.
I think the Gamers 2 went into this thinking they have the stronger laners as players. And I think they underestimated Chantal Mactuau so far.
Yeah.
I think they thought we could just go head-to-head with you and beat you in lane.
Sure.
But look at that. Avenue, 230 CS on that Orianna. He's played it every game in the Challenger Series so far. And he's above the 10 per minute mark, just like his round of 10 game.
Yeah.
A round of 20 game.
Yeah, it's the weird thing, right? Is again, what I talked about in pregame was Chantal Mactuau, actually, as far as solo queue is concerned, are above Gamers 2. Like, I think it's very cool. Oh, the Jinx ulti! Big damage! Have any safe?
Satan's that was off on the side.
Barrier.
He's gonna go for this.
Damage comes through. Ocelot down to half HP. The Q's gonna land Satan. I think he's safe, but maybe this is the first siege really coming in now for
Four
Gamers 2.
See, JWoww here too. Five men.
Yeah, they're all showing up. This will be a lot of turret damage with almost no minions left, but they can tank this up. JWoww has aggro. Teleport comes in. The team is forced back, but that turret was gone if not for the TP.
Now we see Lucian coming in here. They are ready to fight this. Avenue, he has Shockwave available. They get the bottom turret now. And now they're going to counter-siege the mid lane.
There's not amazing wave clear for Gamers 2. It's just the static shift Jinx, really, to keep turrets alive. So there's some defense available for G2, but it's not super-duper strong.
I was a little confused as why they would counter-siege the mid lane here for Chantal Mactuau. I was like,
you
guys have a lot of gold in your pockets.
Yeah.
Go ahead and capitalize on that. Get yourself some more camps.
I mean, they really could have run top lane right then and got it.
Exactly. There's a top lane to take still. Yeah.
So we're going to see them still stay around in the mid lane. Of course, minions had taken that bottom lane turret while it all was happening. And we're going to keep ourselves moving forward. Let's see. Right now, Gamers 2, I think they can go for round 2 in the mid lane siege, and it's likely to work, but I want to see where this kind of starts going. So Lantern's going to get timer on the blue buff. Top lane's already pushing down. That's going to pull Vanna's attention, and his teleport is down. Gamers 2 saw that. They grouped back up towards mid. No one's there really in time to defend. Lucian tries with the ulti, but it's going to be enough damage. There we go. Turret number 3 goes down. It's Gamers 2 bringing it back.
By Chantal Mactuau not to overextend, try to defend the turret, because there was JWoww coming around the side and trying to flank. Now all the outer turrets are down for Chantal Mactuau. They still have Gamers 2's top lane to try and get. But that lane, 30 CS advantage here just from being Aurelia versus Shyvana currently in the game. And he's able to try and push that out. But the big thing here is that Gamers 2, you said that they have great ward coverage in the jungle. They got to start pushing it up now, up against an Orianna who fights very well in the jungle.
Yes, absolutely. The way to win against Chantal Mactuau is sieges are going to be very difficult. You've got to out-position them, out-rotate them, to be completely honest. Satan does not quite get that pink ward down. Diu is going to keep that safe. And we're going to see if Chantal Mactuau can get the team fights going together, though. Their 5-on-5 is actually quite excellent. If they can actually break through the fact they've got a Static Shift Jinx to fight through.
Yeah, that's true. Static Shift Jinx doing really well in CS. Mm-hmm. He's just going to get stronger. The scaling of Jinx is pretty dang good.
More than Lucian's.
Yeah, that's definitely true. The amount of burst that she can bring to a fight, the amount of sustained damage and range. But you can get to her with this team comp. You can get to her very easily.
Well, it's going to be Morden who got found a little bit here. Does clear the ward away, and then I'll take the lantern out. And of course, a new one comes down from
Sight. Another one comes
They're
down.
They're free. You actually rushed a Ruby Sight Stone. I know some pros do rush Ruby Sight Stone, some don't. The actual extra ward in inventory is fairly worthwhile because it basically gives you... you have to back less to replenish wards. You typically just don't put three down, like one will get swept, you've got to replace it. So it makes you recall less. And as far as like stat efficiency goes, it's not too bad for just health gain.
Yeah, it's not that bad at all. A lot of people will omit it and just go for a different item over it. Sometimes it's worth, sometimes it's not. Let's see, going for Satain here, is that worth?
Ooh, does juke back and forth, gets the black shield just to be safe. Q comes out from Lee Sin. Morden, honestly, could have maybe tried to make the play, but that'd be really risky. He doesn't go for it.
This is a tilty dragon fight here. Depending on whose favor this dragon goes in and the team fight,
yeah,
will probably blow the game wide open if it is contested.
Well, right now it's a 500 gold lead for Chantal Machtvau. They're actually going to go to the mid lane to shove the minions out. Smart choice there. Top lane also available if they want to teleport for it. Ocelot getting pushed around. JWoww right now is actually forced to defend that sort of 1v2. But Chantal Machtvau goes back in for this one. G2 is split out. The bind hits on a Morden. This is not good for G2. Damage goes in. Down to half HP. Mid lane gets cleared out, but they could try again soon.
The jungler at half HP is not what you want as gamers too. He cannot contest as easily. Now we have to watch where the shockwave lands and if a binding lands too.
And Vanas gets a black shield. It's going to be on cooldown for a short time, but nullifies the damage. Mid lane once again is pushable, but SMW having the inside track on that lane kind of helps in this one. Blue buff respawns, goes over to Ocelot rather quickly. Should be safely grabbed. Is that way. Satine's still waiting around in the brush, and we have the top laners just kind of fighting each other in the mid lane, pushing the minions back and forth, so no actual advantage still gained for Chantal Machtvau in that one.
Ooh, Vanez looked like he was trying to come around and flank and get straight to Yuki, the Jinx.
Oh wow, big damage is onto him though. He did not realize he was on top of a ward. Big damage went onto him. Sweepers, one is available if they want to sweep that
he
ward.
Still has
saw
TP,
him.
So he can get back into the fight. Also, if he backs right now and cashes in,
yeah,
he could come back to this almost as strong.
Mercred's home guard.
He's got home guard, so he's actually going to run it.
He's going to run to bottom lane. TP if he has to, but there's a big wave that's pushing in that G2 knows someone has to stop. They waited out for that one.
JWoww's on the left side there.
He's looking to flank. There we go. Pulls a lot of attention. Satain chasing that one down, but Dragon still losing health on this one. No, it actually healed back up for a little while there. Damage comes through. Chantel gets hooked. There's a teleport. Chantel's going to explode. 1-0. JWoww comes into the fight. The rocket hits as well from Jinx. Shockwave hits one. And there we go. JWoww's going to get away with the summoner healed. Now Vaughn is in the wrong spot. Exhausted as well. Big damage comes through. Satain now on the wrong side. Gets hooked up, gets blown up. Another kill goes to Gamers 2 as well. Yuki gets rooted, but no one cares. And G2 win that fight 2-0 plus the dragon.
That was the right fight for Gamers 2. And Chantal didn't play that the best. We saw that Chantal went a little too far forward. No black shield there to stop the hook because it was used on Satain right there. It's on cooldown. Throws it in. Immediately blown up there. And JWoww comes into the back line. Puts pressure onto Avenue. Shockwave only hits one. If they'd been about a couple feet units to the right, maybe could have hit three, maybe could have hit four and changed the fight around, but he didn't have the range on it. Wasn't able to throw it out.
Wow, a couple small things there as well. Dude, that hook was from Fog of War. You saw him hiding behind the wall there, knowing he had swept wards away and knew he'd be in the right position to land that hook. As well, when Satain went in for JWoww, he leapt too far and couldn't land his Q, couldn't get the reset on the leap, got stunned by Irelia as well. All of that could have made that a 1-for-1, even still.
Yeah, just really well played there by Gamers, too. They applied pressure from the right points on the right points for them.
Yes, they did.
So Chantal Machtvau have to give up that dragon. They gave up two kills as well. And now it's about a 1.9k gold lead here for Gamers 2.
Yep.
Who have this rally, who's doing really well. Morden.
Uh-oh.
Buy him all by his lonesome.
Going through a ward to get vision control, but of course he's Lee Sin. He ward hops away. He's going to be nice and safe. And, you know, in the end, Gamers 2 still has ward coverage over the blue bob. That's not a bad thing.
Morden risks his life over and over again to ward up the jungle. And it's worth it for him. It's worth it for them at this point in the game because they have to pressure tier 2 turrets and you need that jungle control.
Yeah.
So he's saying, I can do it. I can just ward hop over a wall. If I blow my flash, that's fine. He got an ultimate for that.
Yes, he did.
And didn't trade anything for it.
Pretty impressive stuff there. Avenue's got to be a bit careful. Did go Merc Treads as well. Also, taking some pretty good damage for that one, of course. Wow, look at that, down to about 300 health. He's going to juke away pretty safely. The clone will die. 25 gold, why the heck not? But this does give a bit of room for the team to push down mid lane without the Orianna around. Looks like the wave goes good enough that they can't do it, though.
Yeah. Ocelot's going to have to back on that LeBlanc. Now they're all going top. There is that turret there for them to still take for Chantal Noctval. JWoww, he's actually very, very strong right now. He's hit Aurelia's multiple power spikes at this point just because of his levels.
Well, we're going to ulti burn, though. JWoww will get stunned up there. Binding could land afterwards. Not going to go for that one. Actually, goes back in. Saves. He's got to be careful.
Ooh.
And the Jinx Rocket is going to claim it now. Vaughn is loses the Dragon Form as well. Nice Hook's going to stop that one. He's now in completely the wrong spot. Another 2-0 for Gamers 2. And Shadow Noctval just stopped making good choices.
Yeah, they all went top, but then it was kind of a haphazard call, half-hearted at that part. And they get punished for it. Gamers 2 saw that coming, and now they're looking to go for Baron. Or at least bait it.
I mean, at this point, you kind of... Yeah, you got to see what they're trying to do. Lucian trying to reveal with his W. Ward's still getting swept out. Hook's looking for with Diude. The respawns are coming in soon. Saves his backup. Vaughn's respawning in 15 seconds. Does have home guard. Gamers 2 is still trying to go for the baits here with the hooks over the wall with everything else
he
can they
get
can.
One.
He's going to land on a Chantau. Jumps over, grabs the lantern as well. He's going to bring in the AD carry. And there goes one kill picked up. Nice escape by Ocelot. Gets away from the shockwave. And now Yuki goes for the slow. Can't quite find it. No extra kill picked up there, but again, a 1-0.
Good juke there by Ocelot in the end to get back over the wall.
Yeah.
And they don't get a Baron for this because they've all been chunked down to about half HP. Nice hook. He throws the lantern back. Look at, watch Ocelot here. Boom. Goes straight back over to his distortion. It causes Avenue to waste the shockwave, hitting nobody.
Mm-hmm.
That's actually their key to get back in this game for Chantal Noctval.
Yeah.
Is if that shockwave hits multiple people.
It's a team that wants the team fight. You know, the Flash Black Shield Morgana ulti, he's got Frost Queen's Claim as well to help make sure that those engages actually stick. Shockwave to follow up on this. Like, there's so much AoE potential from SMW. I mean, even just like Shyvana Shockwave into Morgana, like, it's another really, really good combo. But it's not one these guys have found. Gamers 2 kind of refuse to group up until they know they've got the positioning lead. And we haven't seen the team fights that SMW is looking for. Despite the early laning phase lead, they haven't done anything mid-game.
Yeah, and JWoww built the Banshee's Veil first to most likely deal with that. You know, he can eat a binding, that's fine. But at the same time, if he eats a shockwave, it's not going to be as devastating to him. Aurelius typically get something along Randuin's Omen, but he wants to negate the damage from Shyvana, and it also is doubly effective against Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
He's not worried about Chantau and Satane until now.
Yeah, that's right. He's really not even trying that hard. He's starting the Randuin's now, that's fine.
He's got a pickaxe too that he's been sitting on.
Going on Zephyr. Ooh, Hook nearly gets sazed right there. He's going to be okay. Vaughn's still around. Binding comes out there, staying safe. JWoww finds another ward for himself. He's going to kill this one.
Ooh. He's Gamers so scary.
I mean, this is the weird thing, right? It's like Gamers 2 have been winning the fights, but they're only at 3k.
Mm-hmm.
They're not up an appreciable amount of gold. Thing is, I don't know if Chantal Machbaum knows this, because they know they're down in turrets. They know they've lost the dragon fight. They know they're down double the number of kills. Outside of the mid lane, they're getting out-CS'd heavily. But if Avenue can just land something with his Void Staff death cap, like, they can turn a fight. I just haven't seen them really make aggressive moves to show that they're actually close in this game.
Ocelot's going to show himself top right now, which is going to give Chantal Noctval the go signal if they land something.
Well, binding on the Morden, they do hit something, but they just don't go for it. A guaranteed 4v5, and they're too afraid to fight at all.
Yeah, Thresh wasn't quite there yet either. Ocelot gets free time up top, gets the back afterwards, but now there's a huge wave bottom, and they're going to go ahead and get themselves Dragon Control, which will be up in 30 seconds.
Oh, see if they can do it, though. It looks like Recall's going to come back in time. Vaughn's does have Teleport, so does JWoww. And Vaughn does go to the top lane, so you can get that outer turret finally in this game. Bottom and mid had already been killed. Bot lane minion wave actually not even cleared at all, despite the fact that Dragon still isn't back up yet. So missed golden XP by Chantal Noctval. There we go. Yuki grabs the red buff. See, he knows that he's got time to get back down to this side of the map. Right, clear away. Maybe he doesn't need the raise for that one, but we'll do so anyway. And now Gamers 2 is ready to go for Dragon.
JWoww going back up top. He has a level advantage over Vaughn. He's extremely strong on that Aurelia. Aurelia is one of those champions that even if you don't die in lane, or if you get one death, you're still good.
Yep.
Scale incredibly well. Satane's looking for the steal here.
All right, he's ready to jump over the wall. There we go. The damage coming through. Goes in for the steal. Ah, picked up there by Morden. Flashing away. He will be safe with the ward hop. Nice job there. Chantal goes to chase, but was not in the right spot. Say he's going to go down to JWoww. Exhaust not going to be enough to keep him safe. Now they've got to be careful because the AD carry is not in this fight anymore. Satane taking a whole bunch of damage. He's going to go down. JWoww finds himself a double kill as Chantal Machbaugh is taking a whole bunch of damage. Vaughn has to flash the wall, but he's still going to go down. And the fact that Lucian went and chased Morden was catastrophic in that fight.
Yeah, they all got split and sectioned off there, and Avenue didn't even get a shockwave off because he was saying, I don't want to get on just one person. It has to be worth it. Nice burst there by Gamers 2 that was coordinated to take out the dragon. You saw Chantal go over the wall. He's completely out of this fight. He tries to culling JWoww afterwards, but look at that. Avenue just getting zoned, and now they're split completely. Vanis gets sectioned off very, very well from a nice kick from Morden. The dragon's rage to get him out. That's got to be a really pissed off dragon now.
Yeah, dude, the coordination by Chantal Macbeth has not been impressive here as dragon's going down for Gamers 2. Shyvana got a two-man dive under the back line. Orianna was in command protect range and didn't go in for the shockwave there, either on cooldown or didn't realize it was happening.
Oh, hello.
Again, Chantal leaving as well. Morden, I mean, he's fine. He's going to ward hop and be safe. Like, this mid game has not looked good for Chantal Macbeth. They've not been team fighting well. They've had missed communications, mixed calls, people in the wrong spot. Like, Gamers 2 have been taking complete advantage of that.
So this bottom lane from Gamers 2 is still deathless.
Yeah, they are.
Throughout this entire first game so far, and entire round of 10, round of 20, but they even played a losing matchup during the laning phase.
Yeah,
and then they came out on top. Without jungle assistance either. They ended up getting the solo kill.
Yeah, I mean, Lee Sin showed up once and it didn't really do anything. And otherwise, they were just kind of winning the lane by themselves. So excellent play by those guys. JWoww going back down to the bottom lane here to farm up. He does not have teleport, but who cares? Nothing really important for these guys to be up anyway. Dragon and Baron both going to be a while till they respawn. Chantel Machabao, right now they are down about 7,000 gold. That lead is growing, but it's not an insurmountable number if they can find their way back in on this one.
Big thing here is that if you look at the items between Chantel and Yuki, he's up an entire Infinity Edge and Static Shift.
Yeah, and the rest of Static Shift. It's a ludicrous gold lead right there.
On a Jinx.
Yep.
Makes even more use of those items because of attack speed.
60 CS, 3 kills, 6 assists, and global gold. Yeah, that's going to be a lot of money for you right there, and it's showing there. Gamers 2, as long as they're protecting Yuki, and they are, these fights are going super well for them.
This bottom lane is coming up big. Ocelot, he met his match with Avenue in the mid lane. They both went pretty even in CS here. He actually gave up a lot to start roaming. Avenue hasn't died, didn't fall to Ocelot's will during the laning phase. But it's really his bottom lane that started dictating things. And the game got blown wide open there.
All right, well, see if they can find any more on this one. Yeah, it's been blown wide open, and now it's time for them to shut the door on this one, if they can. 7 kills, blue buffs, everything going happy for these guys. And with Baron buff ending in 2 minutes, like, now I'm wondering how much is Gamers 2 like old NIP, where like, we have an advantage.
Yeah.
We're just going to take our time and like close the game up when we feel like it. But this is the kind of case you've got a Jinx. Like, yes, it's hard to siege against Orianna. I know that's difficult, and to siege against Lucian as well, but like, you got to turn the screws at some point.
And a team that doesn't close a game out very quickly when they have a lead, even though they win, tells a lot about their style.
Yeah, and it gives room for teams to make comebacks.
Yeah. Means you weren't as decisive. Means you didn't know how to push the right areas at the right times.
Look for the top lane right now, though. The team does come back to defend. Chantel Macbeth get there just in time. That's going to stay safe. The AD carry could not get there about 20 seconds, 5 seconds sooner. That would have been enough to kill the turret off.
Yeah. Staying safe is actually a really good way to describe this game.
Yeah,
Gamers
very much
two
so.
Have been playing safe. They've been waiting for the mistakes of Chantal Machabao, and then they punish it. Because Chantal Machabao, they're looking for the 5v5 team fight, but they get split up in the fight. Whether it's a Lee Sin kick from Morden, or whether it's Ocelot just popping Chantal.
Yeah.
And now it's starting to culminate into this large lead that Gamers 2 has accumulated in the last 9 minutes.
And there's a big minion wave now in the bottom lane as well that's going to contribute to even more golden XP for Gamers 2 when someone shows up to that. You can push the lane down, but no, look for the pick in the mid lane. Not quite going to find it, though. Say's going to go for the binding, misses that one as well. Big little bit of burst of damage on a Morden. And that bot lane wave is going to suicide into the turret here. Gamers 2 does not pick that one up. And when will they resume the siege? Baron buff ending in 30 seconds. And they only managed to get about one turret with that.
Yuki, they're going to funnel more CS into him. Doing really, really well in terms of CS. I think he'll be number one. There we go. Oh no, he's tied. Tied with JWoww. There we go.
Yay, he's winning.
Woo.
All right, Yuki, number one CS in the game. Almost breaking 10 per minute now. I'm going to recall off of this
one. A lot of fighting.
There has been.
Very recently. So people's CS numbers have started to slack a little bit. Avenue is doing as well as he was previously.
Yeah.
He's still doing very well.
Yeah.
He's the how they get back in. The Shockwave has to land on multiple things. Didn't even use it the last time they fought.
Well, one thing to keep in mind, though, is that as you level up and as you get items, you've got, you know, the Negatron Cloak items coming in for almost every single player now on Gamers 2. Avenue's going for a more utility-based build, right? He went Murktreads, not Sork Shoes. He's going for a Zonya's Hourglass and not like a Liandry's. The actual damage output from Avenue as the most farmed member is not that high. Vaanus is full tank. Shantau is behind. Satane's only got 1.5 damage at him. He's starting on his Last Whisper, so he's going to get some damage eventually here. But like, the actual damage from Shantau Max Vow, even with a Shockwave, is not that high.
Especially compared to Gamers 2.
Yeah.
Which they have an Irelia top who does a lot of damage based on the two damage items that he has accumulated for himself. And the fact that he is Irelia and has that kit. Jinx, Yuki, very far ahead. He's almost at full build here. And also the fact that he's built to counter Avenue's damage. Built to make sure that he will survive a Shockwave and a Dissonance. Mm-hmm. So he doesn't just get completely picked off immediately.
Well, speaking of getting picked off immediately, though, Death... Fire Grasp for Ocelot is going to make life a bit pain. I mean, they're going to keep looking for the individual picks. Again, sieging against Orianna is difficult, but...
This is throwing me back to NIP really hard.
Yeah.
Where Nuke Duck is like, yep, Athene's first item, and then I'll get DFG.
Fourth item DFG. Make sure you can kill people later on. There we go. The top lane move happens there. Gamers 2 going to take down their fifth turret of the game. Bot lane's still really not pushed in just yet, though. They can't get there right away. They will control the blue buff, though, and heck... Baron's back up at about a minute right there. Gamers 2 could wait till that one comes back up. 42 minutes in, blue buff goes over to Ocelot, and at about 43, we're going to have Baron.
Gamers 2 is very hungry, though, for LCS play. Ocelot, he's tried every Challenger series with Gamers 2 to try to get back there. So playing it slow, I don't blame them. There's a lot at stake here, and they put a lot on it.
Yeah. But you got to figure, like...
You want to calculate it. You want to...
I mean, but think about how you're going to qualify for the LCS.
Yes.
You've got to play a best of five against an LCS team. And
exactly.
NIP did that and lost to Millennium because they were too slow to make real moves and win games. So I still have to criticize his play style.
If they adjust
now.
It, though, is the thing.
Here, if they can turn on the aggression, then fine. I mean, for NIP, it was grab Ko and a player who's going to make all the moves for you and then capitalize on them pretty heavily, and that was good. Morden, we haven't seen quite that style from him.
Yeah, very, very,
very
far
slow
oriented.
Early game. Yeah.
Was basically, it was chess in the jungle. With nobody really making any big moves.
Yep.
He's like, oh, you're bottom and you showed yourself, I will take your Wraith. And then they would get countered because he would show top, get nothing for it, and it's like, I take your Wraith.
Yeah. But the risk of getting ganked compared to like countering the Wraith camp is like,
yes.
Not that good of a trade in the first place, but Baron gonna take a whole bunch of damage down. Back to below a quarter health, that's gonna die rather quick with the team starting to leave to defend mid lane as the push comes in from Shantau Max Vow. Baron buff on, respawning at 50 minutes. There we go, bot lane pushed in by Vaanus, mid lane by the rest of the team. Gonna get some decent damage down. That goes, and they're gonna move over to the right-hand side of the map. Another turret's gonna be going down with a flash hook. Nice escape there by Satine and SMW keep moving, but here comes JWoww. Bit of damage comes through. The Frost Queen's claim also pop blue buff attempted here. This is a bit greedy. They will grab it on a Satine, and away they go. JWoww's looking to make some moves here on the side. Jumps on in. Can he find much of the CC? He's not gonna find too terribly much, but there comes Morden. He can't quite kick in Satine, who's got the black shield onto him. So nothing picked up here, but it's still a Baroned up. Gamers 2, can they get the fight? Looks like they won't actually. They allow Shantau Machiavelli to run away with one turret for the Baron.
Vaanus was off on the side there. It looked like he wanted to Dragon's Descent in, but against a Baroned up Gamers 2, which is already ahead by 11k.
You don't
do that.
Gamers 2 are going to look down for this mid lane right here. Vaanus will push this right-hand side lane while they wait for the push to happen. The minions are coming in about 4 seconds, though. Gamers 2 actually going to backdoor this. Here comes the TP. Shantau Machiavelli will have to hold this turret alive against the Baron buff. Looks like they will do so. The defense is going to be fine. The siege not going to happen. Four minions will suicide to that tier 2 turret.
Yuki is a whole item and a half up. Item and, I guess, 3/4 up over Shantau. This is huge. The amount of CS he's accumulated for himself. The fact that there aren't any kills or assists on Shantau, up to the 3-0 and 6, really high in the kill participation department here.
Yeah.
For Yuki. Still zero deaths.
Yeah. Well, speaking of zero deaths, though, JWoww gets to actually pick up a Guardian Angel to keep his total maybe at 1 for this one. Right, they've got the Mikhail's Crucible. You've got the Face of the Mountain there as well for Dude. So the team should be able to stay alive quite well. And right now, if I'm Gamers 2, like, I really want to see them just like get the wards down and actually split push. They're going as a group of five and kind of pushing minion waves in, but they're not like trying to close the game out. Like, your power spikes are going to end right now. Once you're buying defensive items, your damage is going to start falling off. They're going to tank up against you, and as the other team finishes their items, they're going to start catching up to you in power right here. Like, this is the biggest lead Yuki will ever have over Shantou, and it's only going to get smaller from here.
Yes. When you're at six items, you can't get any more. That's about it.
Like, Zephyr's not that big of a power spike. Like, yes, you can, but...
Yeah. And I don't know if he actually wants that, because it'll give him less movement speed than regular boots, and he's very immobile as it is.
True. And yeah, you're absolutely right. That might even not be a choice for him. So there we go. Bottom tier 2 will get grouped up as 5, but now the real test is the inhibitor turrets, 45 minutes in. Going to move on for this one. We have Ocelot split pushing the top lane. Wavefler comes in for Shantou, does keep his turrets in a decent spot. JWoww pops the joke and kills away a couple more minions. Bot lane now getting siege up. There's the rest of the team grouping up mid lane. So the 1-3-1 split push finally starts here for Gamers 2 as Satan tries to wave clear.
JWoww has a lot of threat built into his kit. You don't really see it too much in his items, but oh my word, he does a lot of damage if he gets to you.
Yeah.
It's consistent damage. He won't burst you. He'll be chunking away at you very, very quickly.
Yeah, JWoww full build. One item still to go for Vana's in the top lane. The AD carries. We talked about them a little while ago. Satan does have his last Whisper, so he does have a bit more threat than before. The Zhonya's Hourglass is done here for Avenue, so we'll see if his damage is going to be good enough there on this one. JWoww still splitting. Yuki, thankfully for him, has great range, so he can put good damage to this turret. Ocelot also getting some free attacks down here. Shantou, despite the Banshee's Veil, still must be careful about this one. Vana's JWoww still battling down here. Satan can't quite find his way in. The Gamers 2 slowly getting damage down to these turrets.
That's the name of the game here, is to split push every lane and see if you can actually out-rotate them in a moment's notice, or if one of your lanes just rolls over.
Yeah, and the thing is, these turrets will die incredibly fast when unopposed. Everyone who is split pushing can kill a turret about 10 to 15 seconds. And you've got to wave through all the time. There we go again, bot lane, JWoww taking some damage. Warden shows up, 2-on-2 for this one. Satan forced a bit back, JWoww half HP. These turrets do regen, but very, very slowly.
Yeah, that means there's multiple people down bottom. You get some damage on mid. Ocelot went ahead and rotated there. Now he's off to the jungle. Back to his natural habitat.
And the Baron buff times out. So it's only a 2-turret lead right here. Gamers 2 have already taken down 2 Barons. They farmed plenty of fantasy points doing that, but until the turret goes down in the game, gets picked up, it's, you know, not what really matters for these guys in the Challenger Series. Vana is level 18, still trying to scale up in this one. He's even, like, he's tanky enough now that he can actually stay in this 1v2 against Warden and JWoww and not really be afraid very much. Satan not going to land the slow. Sazed, bit of an early Black Shield there, but might be okay.
Meanwhile, the sieges continue. JWoww is just so tanky. He's not going to get burst down, and he has a Guardian Angel. So if people are camping his body, even if they do kill him, it gives the rest of his team time to work on turrets. And actually killing JWoww and getting the GA is worth it if you can crack an inhibitor turret.
Ooh, Shantou goes for the play, forcing the flash away from Ocelot. I don't know if you can chase any farther than this one, but you're seeing the lack of fear now once they're on defense. Shantou and Machbao actually doing a good job of looking for the fights they want. They hold themselves alive at a 14,000 gold deficit. Baron coming up in 135, Dragon already back, and if I know Gamers too, they'll pick up that gold.
Yep, and they're going to go ahead and go for that dragon, pick up their own buffs from their jungle, and just re-siege up. It's most likely the course of action here. They can't really buy anything else. We're going to see what ends up happening for Yuki if he does get rid of the boots. He bought Furor on him, and yeah, he is. He's going to get rid of him for that Zephyr, so he can go ahead.
Waiting for dragon gold.
Yeah.
And oh, there we go. Ambient gold.
Yeah, because Zephyr's actually really good against this team comp, because if you get hit by a Dark Binding, you have the extra Tenacity,
sure,
which would be one of the kill conditions onto a Jinx.
All right, well, a little bit of ward control goes back to a bit of Shantou Machbao. You're seeing once they realize, like, hey, these guys are missing for a while, and they assume it's Dragon, they get some wards down back in their jungle, so some of these movements will be spotted out. 4 sweepers on the team for Shantou Machbao, so most of these wards have been bought by these guys. Blue buff goes over to Yuki, actually, to keep himself in rocket form longer. Down go the minions.
Rocket form,
yeah, I don't know. Rocket form, minigun form, why not? Rocket stance.
Okay.
She's basically Udyr. Yeah. What would you rather say?
Pow Pow and Fishbones? Switcheroo?
Okay. The mana-consuming form of Switcheroo. There we go. Red buff now. So double buff Yuki. 20 seconds until Baron.
Rocket form just sounds like she turns into a rocket.
Yeah.
Like Nidalee has cougar form.
That's
Spurs
fine.
Spurs don't turn into cougars. She's throwing cats at you like crazy cat lady.
Dude, that'd be awesome. Please, Riot, reverse Nidalee skin. Gamers 2. Okay, they've got decent wards, and they're going to go and set up for this Baron right away. Chantal Machtvau not even trying to stop this one. So Baron 3 now for Gamers 2, 50 minutes in.
Banshee's Veil is the name of the game here for Baron, for Gamers 2 at this point. Look at how little damage they took from that. It's all just regened up even if they took any.
They barely took any.
Eh. Anyway. Moving on. They're ready to siege up the base. All the wards for Chantal Machtvau are on the bottom side of the map. They have no vision of what was happening on that left side. And there we go.
Ooh, Avenir takes some damage. He's going to be safe with the shield. Still has his barrier up if he needs it. Top lane turret actually regens well above half. Now, that was much lower before when Ocelot was sieging there, but not the case. Gamers 2 fully grouping up as just this set of five dudes. But they're not really getting any more damage in this one. The split push hasn't been resumed just yet by these guys. Chantal still has not started the Infinity Edge. He's got a while to go till his full damage comes through. Ocelot again looks for the play there. Avenue half HP. This is the way they're pushing him down. Now they go all in with inhibitor turret. They're going to stay for this one. Big damage comes through. Morgana ulti pops in, and there comes the fight. Shockwave going to land into a little bit right here, but here we go. One kill already picked up in Gamers 2 favor. Vanas goes down 2-0 so far. The chase comes in. Jink Rocket now going to make it a 5-3. The flash engage from JWoww. Can't quite find more. Gets a stun and a save. Saves big damage. The slow, the burst. Ocelot gets his third kill, and now the top inhibitor is gone.
And they just can't get through this front line of Gamers 2 fast enough for Chantal Machtvau.
Nope, the damage not enough to get rid of everybody. Now they're going to try again for inhib turret number 2. JWoww stays alive. The turret falls. They can move now for the second inhibitor. It should be pretty safe for these guys. 40 seconds till the respawn. 2-5. Baron buff still regenerating Gamers 2, 52 minutes into the game. And there we go. The mini wave is there for the top lane turret. They're going to move in on this one. JWoww taking a little bit of turret shots. Doesn't care too much, though. There we go. Next turret number 1. Still the 2v5. Next turret number 2 going to go down as well. The jump on in. Why not just blow up the Orianna? Because they're going to take that one. The Nexus also going to fall. Teleports for good measure. And there is the game. 52 minutes and 6 seconds. And